Hello, dear student. We are continuing online lecture. And please don't forget to write your full name, number of group under the lecture. So let's start. And topic is chronic diseases of the small intestine, chronic diseases of the large intestine, irritable bowel syndrome, and non-specific colitis. So start about chronic diseases of the small intestine, celiac disease, and Whipple's disease. And first of all, discuss about small intestine anatomy. The small intestine, small bowel, lies between the stomach and the large intestine, large bowel, and includes the duodenum, jejunum, and ileum. The small intestine is so-called because its lumen diameter is smaller than that of the large intestine, although it is longer in length than the large intestine. The duodenum continues into the jejunum at the duodeno-jejunal junction or flexure, which lies to the left of lumbar two vertebrae and is fixed to the retroperitoneum by a suspensory ligament of trace. The inferior mesenteric vein lies to the left of the duodeno-jejunal junction. There are several peritoneal fossa around the duodeno-jejunal flexor, which may be the sites of an internal herniation of the small bowel. The rest of the small intestine is a 4-6 meters long convolute tube occupying the center of the abdomen and the pelvis, surrounded on two sides and above by the colon, a part of the large intestine. The ileum continues into the large intestine cecum and the ileocecal junction. The small intestine is differentiated from the large intestine by the presence of mesentery, the absence of tenia coli, and appendicitis epibloche, which are present in the colon. The demarcation between the jejunum and the ileum is not very clear. The main functions of the small intestine are secretion and absorption. The epithelial cells of the small intestine secrete enzymes which digest him into the smallest particle, making them available for absorption. Concurrently, the duodenum functions to mix food with bile and pancreatic enzymes to continue the digestion of carbohydrates, fats, and proteins. Concerning absorption, carbohydrates and proteins are absorbed in the duodenum and jejunum respectively. The jejunum also functions to absorb most fats. The ileum function involves absorption of vitamin B12, bile salts, and all digestion products which were not absorbed in duodenum and jejunum. All three small intestine segments absorb water and electrolytes. Celiac disease. Celiac disease is a common cause of malabsorption of one or more nutrients, also known as celiac sprue or gluten-sensitive enteropathy, is a chronic disorder of the digestive tract that results in an inability to tolerate gliadin, the alcohol-soluble fraction of gluten. Gluten is a protein commonly found in wheat, rye, and barley. Most patients with celiac disease tolerate oats, but they should be monitored closely. When people with celiac disease ingest gliadin, the mucosa of the intestines is damaged by immunologically mediated inflammatory response, resulted in maldigestion and malabsorption. Although celiac disease was originally considered largely a disease of white individuals, especially persons of European descent, recent observations have established that it is a common disease with proton manifestation and worldwide distribution. Celiac disease has had several other names, including non-tropical sprue, celiac sprue, adult celiac disease, and gluten-sensitive enteropathy. Celiac disease is considered as iceberg disease. A small number of individuals have classic symptoms and manifestation related to nutrient malabsorption along with a varied natural history. The onset of symptoms can occur at all points from the first year of life through the eighth decade. A much larger number of individuals have atypical celiac disease, with manifestations that are not obviously related to intestinal malabsorption. Finally, an even larger number of persons have silent celiac disease. They're essentially asymptomatic despite abnormal small intestinal histopathology and serologies. And estimates such as that approximately one person of the Western population is affected, but celiac disease is underdiagnosed in most affected people. Etiology. Celiac disease results from a combination of immunological responses to an environmental factor, gliadin, and genetic factors. First of all, discuss about genetic factors, and genetics play an important role in celiac disease. The incidence of celiac disease in relatives of patients with celiac disease is significantly higher than in the general population. The prevalence in first degree relative of patients with celiac disease is approximately 10%. Concordance for the disease in monozygotic twins approaches 75% is approximately 30% for first degree relatives. And what about immune mechanism? The interaction of alcohol-soluble gliadin in wet barley and rye with the mucosa of the small intestine is crucial to the pathogenesis of celiac disease. Endogenous tissue transglutaminase deamidates glutamine in gliadin, converting it from a neutral to negatively charged protein. Negatively charged gliadin has been shown to induce interleukin 15 in the enteric epithelial cells, stimulating the proliferation of the natural killer cells. Gliadin can produce symptoms and the histologic change in the small intestine when administered to patients with asymptomatic celiac disease. Anti-gliadin antibodies can frequently be identified in untreated patients. Immunoglobulin A antibodies to smooth muscle and mucus and tissue transglutaminase are used for serological diagnosis. However, 3-5% of all patients with celiac disease are immunoglobulin A deficient. Therefore, determine total immunoglobulin A prior to antibody testing is appropriate in patients with celiac disease.
Pathophysiology. A strong association exists between celiac disease and two human leukocyte antigen, HLA haplotypes DQ2 and DQ8. Damage to the small intestine mucosa occurs with the presentation of gluten-derived peptide gliadin consisting of 33 amino acid by the HLA molecules to help T cells. Helper T cells mediate the inflammatory response. Endogenous tissue transglutaminase deamidates gliadin into a negatively charged protein, increasing its immunogenicity. After antibodies to type 2 transglutaminase is a hallmark of celiac disease. Absence of intestinal villi and lengthening of the intestinal crypt characterize the mucosal lesion in untreated celiac disease. More lymphocytes infiltrate the epithelium. Destruction of the obstructive surface of the intestine leads to a maldigestion and malabsorption syndrome. The hallmark of celiac disease is an abnormal small intestinal biopsy and the response of the condition to the elimination of gluten from the diet. The histologic change have a proximal to distal intestinal distribution of severity, which probably reflects the exposure of the intestinal mucosa to varied amount of dietary gluten. And on this picture, you may see normal duodenal mucosa and duodenal mucosa in celiac disease. Pathophysiology of diarrhea. The diarrhea in celiac disease has several pathogenetic mechanisms. Diarrhea may be secondary to first steatorrhea, which is primary result of changes in the duodenal mucosal function. Second, secondary lactase deficiency and consequence of change of duodenal brush body enzymatic function. Third, bile acid malabsorption resulting in bile acid induced fluid secretion in the colon. And fourth, endogenous fluid secretion resulting from crypt hyperplasia. Celiac disease patients with more severe involvement may improve temporally with dietary lactose and fat restriction while awaiting the full effects of total gluten restriction, which constitutes primary therapy. The manifestation of untreated celiac disease can be divided into gastrointestinal symptoms and extraintestinal symptoms. And discuss about gastrointestinal symptoms. Diarrhea is the most common symptom in untreated celiac disease and is present in 45-85% of all patients. Diarrhea caused by celiac disease is due to the maldigestion and malabsorption of nutrients. These stools might be water or semi-formed, like tan or gray, and oily or frozen. These stools have a characteristic for odor. In infants and young children, extensive diarrhea can lead to severe dehydration, electrolyte depletion, and metabolic acidosis. Next symptom, malabsorption of ingested fat or steatorrhea, resulting in the delivery of excessive dietary fat to the large bowel. This results in the production of hydroxy fatty acids by bacteria, which causes secretion of fluids into the intestinal lumen. Next, flatulence and bulbo rigmus. result from the release of gas by the intestinal bacterial flora, fasting of indigested and unabsorbed food materials, and often becomes excess or even explosive. Next, weight loss is variable because some patients might compensate for the malabsorption by increasing their dietary intake. Weakness and fatigue are usually related to the general poor nutrition. In some patients, severe anemia can contribute to fatigue. Occasionally, severe hyperkalemia due to the loss of potassium in the stool can cause muscle weakness. And severe abdominal pain in unusual patients with uncomplicated celiac disease. However, abdominal bloating or cramps with excessive malodorous flatus in common complaint. And extra-intestinal symptoms. Anemia is usually due to the impaired absorption of iron or folate from the proximal small intestine. In severe celiac disease, with ileal involvement, absorption of vitamin B12 may also be impaired. Osteopenia and osteoporosis may develop for several reasons, including defective calcium transport for the diseased small intestine, vitamin D deficiency, and binding of luminal calcium and magnesium to the unabsorbed dietary fat acids. Neurological symptoms that result from hypokalemia include motor weakness, paresthesias with sensory loss, and ataxia. Skin disorders included dermatitis, herpetiformis, is associated in 10 and 12% of patients with celiac disease, and hormonal disorders such as amenorrhea, delayed menarche, and infertility in women and impotence in men have been described. Physical examination. Physical examination finding may reveal the following. Abdominal examination shows a protuberant and tympanic abdomen due to distension of the intestinal loops with fluids and gas. Ascites occasionally can be detected in patients with severe hyperproteinemia. Evidence of weight loss, including muscle wasting or loose skin folds, orthostatic hypertension, peripheral edema, ekhematosis, hyperkeratosis and dermatitis herpetiformis, halosis, glossitis, evidence of peripheral neuropathy, Hvostek sign or Trousseau sign. Diagnosis. A small intestinal biopsy is required to establish a diagnosis of celiac disease. A biopsy should be performed when patient have symptoms and laboratory findings suggestive of nutrient malabsorption and or deficiency, as well as positive TTG antibody test. Since the presentation of celiac disease is often susceptible without overt evidence of malabsorption of nutrient deficiency. Relatively low the hope for biopsy performance is important. The diagnosis of celiac disease requires the detection of characteristic histological changes or small intestinal biopsy together with a prompt clinical and histological response after the institution of a gluten-free diet. The classic changes in duodenal jejunal biopsy are restricted to the mucosa are included first. An increase in the number of intraepithelial lymphocytes. Second, absence of a reduced hide ovule, which causes a small appearance with increased crypt cell proliferation, resulting in crypt hyperplasia and loss of willow structure, with consequent willows but not mucosal atrophy. Third, a suboidal appearance and nuclei that are no longer oriented basally in surface epithelial cells. And last, increased number of lymphocytes and plasma cells in the lamina propria. Treatment approach. Diet, the primary management of celiac disease is dietary, but research into non-dietary therapy is ongoing. Complete elimination of gluten-containing grain products is essential to treatment. Although the majority of patients with celiac disease respond to a gluten-free diet, persistent recurrent symptoms are up to 12%. After an initial period of avoidance, oat might be reintroduced into the diet of patients with celiac disease. This patient should be monitored carefully for recurrent symptoms. Careful and extensive indoctrination of the patient by the physician and the dietarian is often necessary to achieve full compliance. And corticosteroids. A small percentage of patients with celiac disease fail to respond to a gluten-free diet, and some patients who are refractory corticosteroids might be painful in patients who fail to respond to corticosteroids as a comorbid condition, such as lymphomas of the small intestine, have to be ruled out. Our next disease is Whipple disease. And what is this? Whipple disease is a chronic multisystemic disease associated with diarrhea, steatorrhea, weight loss, arthralgia, and central nervous system and cardiac problem, most likely caused by a gram-positive bacterium, Trofarima Whipple. Patient with human immunodeficiency virus infection do not acquire the disease. Whipple disease is extremely rare worldwide. Only several hundred clinical cases have been reported, mostly from North America and Western Europe. The disease appears to be associated with the human leukocyte antigen B12-7. Haptotype. Whipple disease is the most common in white males and rarely described in females. The route of disease transmission is not known but may be associated with occupation, exposure to animal and soil. Whipple disease is usually observed in middle ages and elderly persons. Pathophysiology. The clinical manifestation of the disease are believed to be caused by infiltration of the various body tissue by T. Whipple. The patient's immune system reacts by incorporating the organism into tissue macrophages. These macrophages can be easily observed infiltrating the tissues using conventional light microscopy. The macrophages are easily observed when periodic acid sheath stain is used for histological sections. The malabsorption observed in the small bowel that is associated with condition is believed to be secondary to disruption of normal villus function due to infiltration of the lamina propria or the small bowel. Patients with arthralgias have been found to have the organism in the synovial tissue. The organism have been detected in the heart valves of patients with cardiac Whipple disease. uh, Rarely, the organism can be detected in the lung of affected patients. Clinical presentation. Weevil disease was first described by Dr. George Weevil in 1907. The classic presentation of Weevil disease is that of Western illness characterized by autolysis, arthritis, fever, and diarrhea. However, this form is rare. Lymphadenopathy may be present. This Weevil disease affects the small intestine steatorrhea often is present. The onset of Weevil disease is insidious and is characterized by diarrhea, steatorrhea, abdominal pain, weight loss, migratory large joint arthropathy, and fever as well as ophthalmological ophthalmological symptoms. Dementia is relatively late symptoms and an extremely poor prognostic sign, especially in patients who experience replace after the induction of remission, with antibiotics. Approximately 90% of patients with Weevil disease present with weight loss, and 70% of patients with Weevil disease complain of either diarrhea or arthralgias. In about 3/4 of patients, the joint manifestations are followed by weight loss and diarrhea. With a mean time of 6 years from onset of the joint symptoms to diagnosis of Weevil disease. Local gastrointestinal bleeding can be found in 80% of patients with Weevil disease, but frank hematochezia is uncommon. Cardiac involvement occurs in approximately 30% of cases. The diagnosis of Weevil disease is suggested by a multisystemic disease in a patient with diarrhea and steatorrhea. Tissue biopsy of the small intestine and or other organ that may be involved. Given the patient's symptoms in the primary approach, the presence of PAS-positive macrophage containing the characteristic small bacilli is suggestive of this diagnosis. However, T. Weevil containing macrophages can be confused with PAS positive macrophages containing M. avium complex, which may be a cause of bacteria in ADS. The presence of the T. Weevil bacillus outside of macrophages is a more important indicator of active disease than is there present within the macrophages. T. Weevil has not been successfully grown in culture. approach consideration. The mainstay of medical treatment for management of Weevil disease is antibiotic therapy. Surgery is not part of the therapy for Weevil disease. Once the diagnosis of Weevil disease is established and antibiotics are started, patient may be discharged for continued therapy as outpatient. Consultation with a gastroenterologist, cardiologist, rheumatologist, orthopedist, and neurosurgeon may be necessary for obtaining the appropriate tissue biopsy in selected patient. And outpatient monitoring. Patient with clinical Weevil disease should be monitored with a polymerase chain reaction because it's the most sensitive and specific method to determine if they are responding to antibiotics therapy. T. Weevil has been detected through PCR in normal saliva, gastric juice, and intestinal tissue. uh, Next diseases are chronic diseases of the large intestine, irritable bowel syndrome, and inflammatory bowel disease. And colon anatomy. The large intestine is approximately 1.5 meter long and comprises the cecum, colon, rectum, anal canal, and anus. The structure of the large intestine is very similar to that of the small intestine, except that mucosa is completely devoid of villi. The cecum is about 6 centimeters long and extends downwards into the appendix, a winding tubular sac containing lymphoid tissue. The appendix is thought to be the vestige of redundant organ. Its narrow and twisted shape makes it an attractive site for the accumulation and multiplication of intestinal bacteria. Food residues start by traveling upwards through the ascending colon located on the right side of the abdomen. The ascending colon bends near the liver and the right colic flexure and becomes the transfer colon, passing across to the left side of the abdomen. Just above the spleen and the left colic flexure, the transverse colon becomes the descending colon, which runs down the left side of the abdomen. Before the next bend, the descending colon transforms into the sigmoid colon. The ascending colon, descending colon, and rectum are located in the retroperitoneum. The transverse and sigmoid colon are attached to the posterior abdominal wall, the mesocolon. Distally, the large intestine opens into the rectum, which is continued by the anal canal. The rectum forms the final 20 centimeters of the gastrointestinal tract. It is continuous with the sigmoid colon and connected with the anal canal and anus. Colon function. The large intestine has 3 main functions: absorption of water and electrolytes, formation and transfer of the feces, chemical digestion by gut microbes. And discuss about irritable bowel syndrome. Irritable bowel syndrome is defined as recurrent abdominal pain on average at least 1 day per week in the last 3 months with 2 or more of the following: related to defecation associated with a change in frequency of stool, or associated with a change in form of stool. Irritable bowel syndrome is chronic functional disorders of gastrointestinal tract characterized by chronic abdominal pain and altered bowel habits in absence of an organic disease. The ROM first criteria for the diagnosis of irritable bowel syndrome requires the patient have had recurrent abdominal pain on average at least 1 day per week during the previous 3 months that is associated with 2 or more of the following: related to defecation, associated with a change in stool frequency, associated with a change in stool form or appearance. And irritable bowel syndrome have several variants. Variants may be with predominant constipation, variants with predominant diarrhea, and variants with mixed bowel habits, and variant unclassified. Patient who meets diagnostic criteria for irritable bowel syndrome, but whose bowel habits cannot be accurately categorized into the one of the 3 subtypes above. Pathophysiology. Traditional theories regarding the pathophysiology of irritable bowel syndrome maybe with oocyte as a three-part complex of altered gastrointestinal motility, visceral hyperalgesia, and psychopathology. More recently, it's believed can components of the gut microbiota potentially influence brain morphology and function, behavior and cognition, which expands the paradigm of the gut-brain axis. Altered gastrointestinal motility includes distinct aberration in the small and large bowel motility. The mere electric activity of the colon is composed of background slow waves with superimposed spike potential. Patients who are prone to diarrhea demonstrate this alteration to a greater degree than patients who are prone to constipation. Small bowel dysmotility manifestates is delayed meal transit in patient prone to constipation and accelerated meal transit is patient prone to diarrhea. And has perception of normal motility and visceral pain characterizes irritable bowel syndrome. Rectus sigmoid and small bowel inflation produce pain and lower volumes in patients than in control. Patients who are affected describe widened dermatomal distribution of referred pain. Association between psychiatric disturbances and irritable bowel syndrome pathogenesis are not clearly defined. And what about clinical presentation? Constipation result is complaint of hard stool, narrow caliber, painful or infrequent defecation and intractability to laxatives. Diarrhea usually is described as small volumes or loose stool with evocation preceded by urgency or frequent defecation. Postprandial urgency is common and alternation between constipation and diarrhea. And next, symptoms, abdominal pain. Description of proton. Pain frequently is diffused without radiation. Common sites of pain include the lower abdomen, specifically the left lower quadrant. Acute episodes of sharp pain are often superimposed on a more consult dull ache. Meals may precipitate pain and defecation commonly improve pain. Defecation may not relieve pain, however. Pain from premuse gas pocket in the splenic flexure may masquerade anterior chest pain or left upper quadrant abdominal pain. Next symptom, abdominal bloating or distension. Patients frequently report increased amount of bloating and gas. People with irritable bowel syndrome may manifest increase in abdominal circumference throughout the day as assessed by computer tomography scan. Patient with irritable bowel syndrome has overall healthy appearance but may be tense of or exhaust. The patient may present with sigmoid tenderness or palpable sigmoid cord. And symptoms non-consistent with irritable bowel syndrome should alert the clinician to the possibility of an organic pathology. Inconsistent symptoms include the following: onset in middle and older age, acute symptoms, progressive symptoms, nocturnal symptoms, anorexia or weight loss, fever, rectal bleeding, painless diarrhea, steatorrhea, gluten intolerance. Management of irritable bowel syndrome consists primarily of providing psychological support and recommending dietary measures. Pharmacological treatment is adjuvative and should be directed at symptoms such as modulation and persistent visceral hyperalgesia. In 12 or 10, American colleague or gastroenterologist position statement concluded psychological intervention, cognitive behavior therapy, dynamic psychotherapy, and hypnotherapy are more effective than possible. Frequent visit with a clinician enhance the patient-provider relationship, especially in patients who were recently diagnosed with irritable bowel syndrome. Visit can become less frequent and patients are educated and reassured. Next disease, inflammatory bowel disease. Inflammatory bowel disease is an idiopathic disease caused by a dysregulated immune response to host intestinal microflora. The two main types of inflammatory bowel disease are ulcerative colitis, which is limited to the colonic mucosa, and Crohn's disease, which can affect any segment of the gastrointestinal tract from the mouth to the anus, involves skin lesion, and is transmural. Three characteristics define the etiology of inflammatory bowel diseases: genetic predisposition, an altered dysregulated immune response, and altered response to gut microorganisms. The manifestation of inflammatory bowel disease generally depends on the area of intestinal tract involved. The commonly experienced symptoms of Crohn's disease include recurrent abdominal pain and diarrhea. Sometimes the diagnosis may be delayed by several months to a few years, as the symptoms are not specific for this disease. Patients with inflammatory bowel disease may have symptoms of irritable bowel syndrome with cramping, irregular bowel habits, and passage of mucosa without blood or pus. Systemic symptoms are common in inflammatory bowel disease and include weight loss, fever, sweats, malaise, and autolysis. A low-grade fever may be the first warning sign of a flare. Patients are commonly fatigued, which is often related to the pain, inflammation, and anemia that accompany disease activity. Recurrences may occur with emotional stress, infection, or other acute illnesses, pregnancy, dietary problems, use of cathartic or antibiotic, or non-adherence to therapy. The World Gastroenterology Organization indicated the following symptoms may be associated with inflammatory damage in the digestive tract: diarrhea, constipation, bowel movement abnormalities, abdominal cramping and pain, nausea and vomiting. Non-specific ulcerative colitis. Ulcerative colitis was first described in 1975 by two English physicians, Wilkes and Moxon, who distinguished it from diarrheal diseases caused by infectious agents. Pathophysiology. The common end pathway of ulcerative colitis is inflammation of mucosa and intestinal tract, causing ulceration, edema, bleeding, and fluid and electrolytes loss. In several studies, genetic factors appear to influence the risk of inflammatory bowel disease. by causing of disruption of epithelial barrier integrity, deficits of autophagy, deficiency in the native pattern recognition receptor, and a problem with lymphocyte differentiation, especially in Crohn's disease. Inflammatory mediators have been identified in inflammatory bowel disease, and considerable evidence suggested that these mediators play an important role in the pathologic and clinical characteristic of these disorders. Cytokines, which are released by macrophages in response to various antigenic stimuli, bind to different receptor and produce autocrine, paracrine, and endocrine effects. Cytokines differentiate lymphocyte into a different type of T cells. In ulcerative colitis, the inflammation begins in the rectum and extends proximally in an interrupted fashion to the proximal colon, and could eventually involve the entire length of the large intestine. Histologic findings correlate well with the endoscopic appearance and clinical course of ulcerative colitis. The process is limited to the mucosa and superficial submucosa, which keep a layer uninfected except in fulminant disease. In ulcerative colitis, two major histological features suggest chronic city and help distinguish it from infection and acute self-limited colitis. On this picture, you may see macroscopic view when patient have ulcerative colitis. And ulcerative colitis is mucosal disease that usually involves the rectum and extends proximally to involve all part of the colon. Proximal spread occurs as continuity without aureoles or uninvolved mucosa. When the whole colon is involved, the inflammation extends 2-3 centimeters into the duodenum ileum in 10-12% of patients. The endoscopic changes of backwash ileitis are superficial and mild and are little clinical significance. Although variation in macroscopic activity may suggest key barriers, biopsies of normal appearing mucosa and usually abnormal. Thus, it is important to obtain multiple biopsies from apparently involved mucosa via proximal or distal during endoscopy. One covered in the effective medical therapy can change the appearance of the mucosa, such as the ski barriers or the entire colon can be microscopically normal. Signs and symptoms. The major symptoms of ulcerative colitis are diarrhea, rectal bleeding, tenesmus, passage of mucosa, and cramp and abdominal pain. The severity of symptoms correlate with the extent of disease. Although ulcerative colitis can present acutely, symptoms usually have been present for a week to months. Occasional diarrhea and bleeding are so intermittent and mild that the patient doesn't seek medical attention. Laboratory endoscopic and cardiographic feature. Active disease can be associated with a rise in acute phase reactants, platelets count and erythrocyte disseminization rate, and a decrease in hemoglobin. Fecal lactoferrin and lipoprotein present in activated neutrophils is a highly sensitive and specific marker for detecting intestinal inflammation. Fecal calprotein is present is neutrophils and monocytes and levels correlate well with histological inflammation, predict relapses, and detected porchititis. Both fecal lactoferrin and calprotectin are becoming an integral part of inflammation bowel disease germ management and are used frequently to rule out active inflammation versus symptom of irritable bowel or bacterial overgrowth. In severely ill patients, the serum albumin level will fall rather quickly. Leukocytosis may be present but is not a specific indicator of disease activity. Proctitis or proctosigmoiditis rarely causes ARIES and C-reactive protein. Sigmoidoscopy is used to assess disease activity as is usually performed before treatment. If the patient is not having acute flare, colonoscopy is used to assess disease extent and activity. Endoscopically mild disease is characterized by erythema, decreased vascular pattern, and mild variability. Moderate disease is characterized by marked erythema, absent vascular pattern, variability, and erosions. And severe disease by spontaneous bleeding and ulceration. Histologic features change more slowly than clinical features, but can also be used to grade disease activity. And you may see healthy colon on the left and ulcerative colon on the right. And the next disease is Crohn's disease. Crohn's disease was first described in 1932 by three doctors. At the time, any disease in the small intestine was thought to be intestinal tuberculosis. Pathophysiology. Crohn's disease can affect any portion of the gastrointestinal tract from the mouth to the anus and causes three patterns of involvement: inflammatory disease, structure, and fistulas. This disease consists of segmental involvement by a non-specific granulomatous inflammatory process. The most important pathologic feature of Crohn's disease is that it is transmural, involving all layers of the bowel, not just the mucosa and the submucosa, which is characteristic of ulcerative colitis. Furthermore, Crohn's disease is discontinuous with skip areas interspersed between two or more involved areas. Late in the disease, the mucosa develop a cobblestone appearance, which results from deep longitudinal ulceration interfaced with intervening normal mucosa. Diarrhea, cramping, and abdominal pain are common symptoms of Crohn's disease in all of the above locations except for the gastroduodenal region, in which anorexia, nausea, and vomiting are more common. Rectal sparing is a typical but non-constant feature of Crohn's disease. Crohn's disease can affect any part of the gastrointestinal tract from the mouth to the anus, unlike ulcerative colitis, which almost always involves the rectum. The rectum is often spared in Crohn's disease. Active Crohn's disease is characterized by focal inflammation and formation of fistula tract, which result by fibrosis and stricture of the bowel. The bowel wall thickens and becomes narrowed and fibrotic, leading to chronic recurrent bowel obstructions. Projections of thickened mesentery encase the bowel, and serosal and mesenteric inflammation promote adhesion and fistula formation. signs and symptoms. Although Crohn's disease usually presents as acute or chronic bowel inflammation, the inflammatory process evolves toward one of two patterns of disease: a fibrostenic obstructing pattern or a penetrating fistulose pattern, each with different treatments and prognosis. The site of disease influences the clinical manifestation. Ileocolitis. Because the most common site of inflammation is a terminal ileo, the usual presentation of ileocolitis is a chronic history of recurrent episodes of right lower quadrant pain and diarrhea. Sometimes the initial presentation mimics acute appendicitis with pronounced right lower quadrant pain, a palpable mass, fever, and leukocytosis. Pain, usually colicky, is preceded and is relieved by defecation. A low-grade fever is usually not. High spiking fever suggested intra-abdominal abscesses formation. Weight loss is common, typically 10-12% of body weight, and develops as a consequence of diarrhea, anorexia, and fear of eating. Next symptoms, jejunal ileitis. Extensive inflammatory disease associated with a loss of digestive and absorptive surface, resulting in malabsorption and steatorrhea. Nutritional deficiency can also result from poor intake and enteric losses of protein and other nutrients. Intestinal malabsorption can cause anemia, hypoalbuminemia, hypocalcemia, hypomagnesemia, coagulopathy, and hyperoxaluria with nephrolithiasis in patients with inept colon. Many patients need to take oral and often intravenous iron. Vertebral fracture caused by a combination of vitamin D deficiency, hypokalemia, and prolonged glucocorticoid use. Pellagra from myosin deficiency can occur in extensive small bowel disease, and malabsorption of vitamin B12 can lead to megaloblastic anemia and neurological symptoms. Other important nutrient to measure and lead if low folate and vitamin A, E, and K. And next, symptoms, colitis and perianal disease. Patient with colitis present with low-grade fever, malaise, diarrhea, crampy abdominal pain, and sometimes hematochezia. Growth bleeding. Bleeding is not as common as in ulcerative colitis and appears in about one half of patients with exclusively colonic disease. Laboratory endoscopic and radiographic fusion. Laboratory study results are generally non-specific but may be helpful in supporting the diagnosis and managing the disease. Serologic studies are sometimes used to facilitate differentiation of Crohn's disease from ulcerative colitis on inflammatory bowel disease or undetermined time. Capsule endoscopy is sensitive for early mucosal inflammation, but it can only detect mucosal change, whereas MRI and intestinal ultrasonography are able to reveal transpural inflammation as well as identify complications. Ultrasonography, computer tomography scanning, and MRI can determine pre-treatment and post-treatment disease activity or identify disease complication. Endoscopic feature of Crohn's disease include rectal sparing, afterwards ulceration, fistulas, and skip lesion. Plain radiography or computer tomography scanning of the abdomen can be used to assess the bowel obstruction. The studies can also be used to assess and pelvis for the presence of any intra-abdominal abscesses. And about extra-intestinal manifestation of inflammation bowel disease. Dermatological, and for example, erythema nodosum occur in up to 15% of Crohn's disease patients and 10% of ulcerative patients. Attack usually correlates with bowel activity, skin lesion develop after the onset of bowel symptoms, and patients frequently have concomitant active peripheral arthritis. next disease, and dermatological disease, pyoderma gangrenosum, is seen in 1-12% of ulcerative colitis patients and less commonly in Crohn's colitis. It is usually associated with severe disease. Lesions are commonly found on the dorsal surface of the feet and legs, but may occur on the arm, chest, stomach, and even the face. This disease usually begins as a pustula and when spread concentrically to rapidly undermine healthy skin. Lesion then ulcerate with vulvous edges surrounded by a margin of erythema. And other dermatological manifestations include pyoderma vegetans, which occurs in interregional areas, pyostomatitis vegetans, which involves the mucous membranes, Swiss syndrome, and neutrophilic dermatosis, and metastatic Crohn's disease, a rare disorder defined by cutaneous granuloma formation. And psoriasis affects 5-10% of patients with inflammatory bowel disease and unrelated to bowel activity, consistent with a potential shared immunogenetic basis of this disease. Diseases. Next complication, rheumatologic. For example, peripheral arthritis develop in 15-12% of inflammatory bowel disease patients, in more common in Crohn's disease, and worsens with exacerbation of bowel activity. It is asymmetric, polyarticular, and migratory, and most often affects large joints of the upper and lower extremities. Next, rheumatologic disease, ankylosing spondylitis, occurs in about 10% and more common in Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. About 2/3 of inflammatory bowel disease patients with ankylosing spondylitis express the HLA B27 antigen. Next, disease, sacroiliitis, is symmetric, occur equally in ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. It's often asymptomatic, doesn't correlate with bowel activity, and doesn't always progress to ankylosing spondylitis. Other rheumatic manifestation include hypertrophic osteoarthropathy, pelvic or femoral osteomyelitis, and replacing polychondritis. Next, hepatobiliary. Hepatic steatosis is detectable in about 1/2 of the abdominal liver bill size of patient with Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. Patient usually present with hepatomegaly. Fatty liver usually result from a combination of chronic debilitating illness, malnutrition, and glucocorticosteroid therapy. Cholelithiasis occur in 10-35% of Crohn's disease patient with ileitis and ileoresection. Gallstone formation caused by malabsorption of bile acid, resulting in depletion of the bile salt pool and the secretion of lithogenic bile. Primary sclerosing cholangitis is a disorder characterized by both intrahepatic and extrahepatic bile duct inflammation and fibrosis, frequently leading to bile cirrhosis and hepatic failure. Most patients have no symptoms at this time of diagnosing. When symptoms are present, they consist of fatigue, jaundice, abdominal pain, fever, anorexia, and nausea. Ocular and urologic disease. The incidence of ocular complication is inflammatory bowel disease patients in 1-10%. The most common are conjunctivitis, anterior uveitis, iritis, and episcleritis. The most frequent genitourinary complications are calculi, ureteral obstruction, and ileoblastic fistulas. And treatment of inflammatory bowel disease. Treatment is made of the basic of the disease site pattern, activity, and severity. The general goals of treatment as follows: to achieve the best possible clinical, laboratory, and histological control of inflammatory disease with the least adverse effect from medication. To permit the patient to function as normally as possible, in children to promote growth with adequate nutrition. And what is drugs? 5-ASA agents. These agents are effective in including and maintaining remission ulcerative colitis. They may have a limited role in inducing remission in Crohn's disease, but not clear role in maintenance of Crohn's disease. Neosulfa-free aminosalicylate preparation deliver increased amount of the pharmacologically active ingredient sulfasalazine to the site of active bowel disease while limiting systemic toxicity. There are four main 5 aminosalicylic acid drugs. Belsalazide, mesalazine, olsalazine, and sulfasalazine. Next drugs are glucocorticosteroids. The majority of patients with moderate to severe ulcerative colitis benefit from oral or parenteral glucocorticosteroids. Prednisone is usually started at dose of 40-60 mg a day for active ulcerative colitis that is unresponsive to 5-ASAA therapy. Parenteral glucocorticosteroid may be administered as hydrocortisone 300 mg a day or methylprednisolone 40-60 mg a day. And new corticosteroid for ulcerative colitis, budesonide, is released entirely the colon and has minimal to no glucocorticosteroid side effect. The dose is 9 mg a day for 8 weeks and no type is required. Topically applied glucocorticosteroids are also beneficial for distal colitis and may serve as an adjunct in those who have rectal involvement plus more proximal disease. Next drugs are antibiotics. Antibiotics have no role in the treatment of active ulcerative colitis, usually respond to treatment with metronidazole and or ciprofloxacin. Metronidazole is effective active inflammatory, fistulizing, and perianal prone disease, and may prevent recurrence after ileal resection. And used effective dose is 15-12 milligram on a kilogram per day in 3 divided doses. And ciprofloxacin used 500 milligram bit is also beneficial for inflammatory, perianal, and fistulizing Crohn's disease, but has been associated with tendinitis and tender eruption. Next, drug azathioprine and sigmercatoprine in methotrexate. Azathioprine and sigmercatoprine are purine analogs used concomitantly with biologic therapy or less often as a sole immunosuppressant. And methotrexate inhibits dehydrogenase reductase, resulting in the pyDNA synthesis. Additional anti-inflammatory properties may be related to decrease in the production of IL-1. Cyclosporine. A lipophilic peptide with inhibitory effects on both the cellular and humoral immune system. This drug binds to cyclophilin, and this complex inhibit calcineurin and cytoplasmic phosphatase enzyme involved in the activation of T cells. And biologic therapy is now commonly given as an initial therapy for patients with moderate to severe Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. Patients who respond to biologic therapies enjoy improvement in clinical symptoms, a better quality of life, less disability, fatigue, and depression, and fewer surgeries and hospitalization. And anti-TNF therapy, biological therapy, tumor necrosis factor, aka inflammatory cytokine and mediator of intestinal inflammation, is expressed prominently in inflammatory bowel disease. Patients likely to benefit from anti-TNF therapy include the following. Patients who have moderate to severe debilitating symptoms of Crohn's disease, who have documented active inflammation, or who are dependent on corticosteroids and unable to taper this agent without return of symptoms. Patients who do not show evidence of active bowel infection and cause of gastrointestinal symptoms. And anti-integrins. Integrins are expressed on the cell surface of leukocytes and serve a mediator of leukocyte adhesion to vascular endothelium. alpha for integrin alone visit beta 1 and beta 7 subunit interact with endothelium ligand termed adhesion molecule. Interaction between alpha 4, beta 7 and mucosal adhesion cellular adhesion molecule is important in lymphocyte trafficking to gut mucosa. And what use? Natalizumab, vedolizumab, and ustekinumab. And pharmacological therapy for diarrhea. Diarrhea may develop a result of active disease. Other possible causes include acute infection, bacterial overgrowth, loss of ileocecal valve, short bowel syndrome, lactase deficiency, concomitant celiac disease, and functional bowel syndrome. Chronic diarrhea in Crohn's disease respond well to anti-diarrheal agents such as loperamide, bile acid binders, diphenoxylate with atropine, and tincture of opium. Such agents should be considered with care in active colitis because of the risk of toxic megacolon. And surgical therapy. Indication for surgical therapy if patient have ulcerative colitis, intractable disease, fulminant disease, toxic megacolon, colonic perforation, mesocolonic hemorrhage, extracolonic disease, colonic obstruction, colon cancer prophylaxis, colon dysplasia or cancer, and for Crohn disease, small intestine structure and obstruction, unresponsive to medical therapy, massive hemorrhage, refractory fistula abscess, and colon and rectum, untractable disease, fulminant disease, perianal disease, unresponsive to medical therapy, refractory fistula, colonic obstruction, cancer, prophylaxis, colon dysplasia, or cancer. And nearly all, one half of patients with extensive chronic ulcerative colitis undergo surgery within the first 10 years of their illness. And what about complication of inflammatory bowel disease? Intestinal complication associated with several gastrointestinal complications, including risk of hemorrhage, perforation, structure, and fistula, as well as perianal disease and related complications such as perianal and pelvic abscesses, toxic megacolon, and malignancy. And extra-intestinal complication. Extra-intestinal complication occur in approximately 20-25% of patients with inflammatory bowel disease. In some cases, they may be more symptomatic than the bowel disease itself. They include osteoporosis, hypercoagulability resulting in venous thromboembolism, anemia, gallstones, primary sclerosing, cholangitis, aftosis, ulcers, arthritis, iritis, episcleritis, and skin complication. Thank you for your attention. If you have question, please leave your question under the lecture and see you on next next Thursday with a new lecture. Thank you. Goodbye.